Howdy. Okay, I know this looks bad, but let me explain. Let me tell you the tale of the freeze frame bonus from Toby's games that broke me. Real quick, spoilers for Deltarune and Undertale. Don't hassle people about the text-to-speech, and be nice to your fellow theorists. Okay, let's go. First, I have a confession. I may have made a mistake last video, and honestly it boggles my mind, because in the first 12 hours this video got thousands of views, and none of us caught this, even though I know we all saw this sprite before. How do I know we all saw it? Because it's used every time we enter the closet in Chapter 2. Right here. Did you catch it? I didn't. When someone told me I missed it and I double-checked the footage, I actually felt relieved, until I remembered who I was dealing with and decided to go frame by frame. And oh, okay, there's Kris's smaller sprite being scrunched up. That's actually a pretty common way to convey a springing motion, since it's using squash and stretch principles, which is one of the 12 principles of animation. But that's fine, because next frame he's going to spring forward right into his normal running sprite, conveying the stretch. Or, not? What? Did Kris just shrink? Susie too. What in the heck? This baffles me. Looking into the code, like I should have done the first time, this is only used in the Dark World transition, which suggests Toby made this sprite specifically for this cutscene. But that doesn't make any sense because not only does it not follow the rules of animation, it also only plays for 8 frames. That's too fast to even be visible. Why would you do that? I know Toby knows that's too fast to register. You know how? Because he does this on purpose in Undertale. When Alphys is pretending to defend you from Mediton, there's a moment right here where Alphys forgets her line, and Mediton feeds it to her. This lasts about 15 frames, and has a sound cue, yet a lot of players still miss it. But what's even harder to catch is right after, when Alphys jumps in to say the line, there's a super brief moment, only 8 frames long, where she makes this face. I swear Toby puts these in just to mess with video editors. Toby delights in putting these little Easter eggs in places almost no one will ever see, and there are a ton of more well-known instances of him doing this sort of thing in his games. But those all add some kind of world-building or hidden character lore, so what was the purpose of this one? I know it might have just been laziness, but I really doubt it, because the game files surrounding this cutscene seem to be implying that he worked very hard on this part of the animation, and had other editors assisting him to make sure it looked just right. So was shrinking them intentional? If so, it might be implying that the Dark Worlds make Kris and Susie remember their childhood, in the same way this one here does for Noelle. Or, it could be a way to hide the existence of a cutscene. Removing assets from a video game can be pretty tricky, because even if you remove the cutscene itself, there can be parts of the code that still in some way access the assets you built for it. And if you remember the crazy glitchiness of that recent 1.09 patch, you know how hard it can be to find and address every single instance of that in something as massive as a video game. So it is still possible that Toby initially made a cutscene, and then when he cut it, he put the sprite for it here to reduce suspicion from data miners, but that's making a lot of assumptions and conjecture with very little evidence, so try not to treat that possibility as fact, alright? Well, okay, I hear you say, you made a mistake, but that's not so bad. But no. You don't understand, this isn't the freeze frame bonus that broke me. Because, as I was editing this video, I remembered the freeze frame bonus that I actually caught on my first playthrough. What epic secret did I stumble upon first try? Well, you see, skilled gamer that I am. I died to Toriel almost immediately. Oh yes, to all of you pro gamers out there, wondering why I'm walking directly into the bullets in half the footage, that's up. Look, I'm not a speedrunner, alright? But that's okay. Half the secrets in this game can only be found by failing horribly. It's fine. This is how science happens. So since this was so easy, I figured I'd just go grab that screenshot real quick. No big deal. I was so wrong. The first hurdle was just switching out my armor on an old save. I figured all I needed to do was re-equip the bandage, but Oh, that isn't re-equippable. That's fine, I know how to swap it out in code, no big deal. So now, with our decreased defense, we just head into battle and Oh, this is much harder than I thought. By now, most of you probably know that if you start a round against Toriel with critically low health, she'll avoid hitting you with the bullets. What you may not know is that if you start a round with just slightly low health, she'll also reduce the damage done by the bullets. So just start a turn with 3 health? Well, no, because she also ends the turn early if you get hit when starting with health that low. So okay, I just need to start a round with enough health for her to do 3 damage per hit, and then get hit a couple extra times. That's not too hard, right? Ugh. Wargle. Why? Haha. Yay. I finally died. I don't know how I managed it, but I did. Now I just have to play back the footage and, wait. Where is it? I know I died against her. Did I dream it up? Was this screenshot ever real? What's going on? Well, it turns out all that video making is slowing my PC down, but that's fine. We'll just optimize OBS a bit to see if we can't fix the lag. Oh, that made it worse. Okay, I finally fixed it. So I died to Toriel, again, and... I am so angry right now. What was I doing before? Grabbing 2 seconds of footage for a video about times I messed up in my videos. Sorry guys, listing off all the cats I missed is gonna have to wait. I need to know why this is happening. You know why? Because when I went online to find a walkthrough, all I found was other people having this problem. So now it's personal. Now, we're going into the code. The battle code for these games is kind of a mess to read, but after much frustration, I've decided the best way to start is with this variable here, the global HP. From what I can tell, and again, I'm just a frog and I'm not a coder, but it looks like this is the variable that tracks your current health, and it looks like she reads it at the start of each turn. So why is this happening? Why are the bullets getting weaker mid-turn? Well, it seems like the bullets are also checking your current health and responding accordingly, but not on every turn. I believe that if you start the turn with health that is lower than 8, the bullets will start reading your health in real time and reduce it within the same turn. So all we have to do is jump into the battle with 8 health and... Darn it, but why?
20 minutes later.
Okay, I think I've cracked the code. Not through reading it, I'm clearly awful at that, but by experimentation. It seems that bullets do 3 to 4 damage at full health, and 1 damage below 8 health. But what if your health is somewhere in the middle? Well, if your health is between 12 to 9, it looks like bullets tend to pick a number between 1 to 3. I don't know why that happens, but that seems to be what's happening. Except this attack with the hand? This one is annoying because hitting the hand instantly stops the fight, and the bullets always seem to do very little damage. So, here is the strategy. Step 1, go to the rotating switch room and fight some enemies. You want to get your health to either 9 or 10. Most bullets do 2 damage, but Vegetoid's dinner heals for 1 and devour for 5, and Mold Small does 1 damage, so if you want an uneven number to start with, that is the way. As you walk to Toriel, resist the impulse to save, as that would restore your health. And then the moment the fight starts, check the attack. If it's the hand, move down to this bottom left corner, and once it's off screen, head to the right. The bullets should move down to hit you, but the one on the right is slower, so you should have time to move back over to the right before it hits you. The moment you get a different attack, you want to run into the bullets. Most of them start at the top and move down, so the easiest method is usually to head straight up into the street and then follow it down. If it pools down at the bottom like this, then once you follow it down, you can just sit at the bottom and let the fire burn you. Most of the time this should kill you, but if it doesn't, do not despair. Just use a healing item and try to reduce your health again. Remember, you want to get somewhere in the 9 to 12 health range so you start a turn without triggering the low health flag. It can take some patience, but soon enough. Huzzah. Yay. That only lasts for about 4 frames, so if your game or recording software is lagging, you might not see it. But even at only 4 frames, Toriel's sprite is so big that I definitely saw that on my first playthrough. And that, dear viewers, is why my first run was not a pacifist run. Yep. I think people are a little quick to be a bit reductive when it comes to skill-based tasks, right? Like either you are good at dodging or bad at it, but I think that's a bit of an oversimplification. You can be good at dodging certain patterns but bad at dodging others, right? And with Toriel, I tend to find that the reasons people die to her aren't because they're bad at the game, or even that they're very skilled at dying. It's a complex algorithm dependent on how quickly they use their healing items, what armor they equipped, and even the RNG for how much damage the bullets do. You can be bad at dodging, but happen to start a turn with 2 HP, and then the fight is unlosable. Or you can be good, but not perfect, at dodging and happen to get hit at just the wrong times. So unless you're perfect at dodging, there's always going to be a chance you get killed, regardless of your skill or strategy. So next time you see someone critically fail something simple, whether it's spotting a super obvious sign in a grocery store, solving a simple puzzle, or missing something obvious in a video game, try not to read it as laziness or stupidity. Remember, it's okay to fail sometimes, because failure can be an opportunity for discovery. Okay, I'll get off the soapbox now. What do you all think? Are there any other epic freeze frames that I missed? I bet there's a bunch, so leave them down below. Have you ever died to Toriel or gotten stuck trying to? If so, try out these tips and let me know if they work for you. Thanks for sticking with me, soapbox, mistakes and all. And until next time.
Don't forget to like and subscribe for more Hyperlink Blocked.